Celebrate, no, Pete Osborne, and we are honored that we have been asked to host today's celebration of the life of David Compton.
David Compton was a better actor than you.
Even though you don't always think so, it's true, Brian.
Nate and I are going to take a few minutes to read a list of names of actors that David Compton was better than.
Number one.
Are you going to do them in order?
Yeah, I put them together in order.
Are you on there?
Yeah, but towards the bottom, even Brian Russell is a better actor than me.
Actor in Nashville by the Readers of the Tennessean three times, and only beaten once by David Compton.
I think of you more as a friend.
What number am I on your friend list?
Well, there's an opening at the top of the list.
That's as dark as it gets, we promise.
I hope that we don't have to meet in this room for this reason many more times ever. Our community has suffered unimaginable loss this year. Our family has lost something that cannot be replaced. I wish that I could reach out and glue our broken hearts back together, and I am so sorry that I cannot.
It's not possible for us to fully encapsulate what David was to each of us or the scope of his whole life because his life was so well lived. So we're going to do the very best we can to express how much David meant to this community and everyone in this room.
We actually had the discussion about who to list as honorary pallbearers, but the truth is, everyone here today is a pallbearer.
Today we're going to lift David up and we're going to do it together.
After this memorial, we hope that we can all step right up there in the lobby and share stories about David, because we want to hear every single one of you.
Although David was a brilliant director, set designer, and choreographer, David Compton really was our finest actor. And it's not that we wanted to be better than him, it's that we just wanted to share the stage with him.
The truth of the matter is, being in the audition room or on the stage with David Compton, you just hoped that you would keep up. He was more prepared than you. He was more engaged than you. He was so honest and vibrant in the room that we all paled in comparison.
He made us all want to rise to his level. David Compton made Nashville theater better.
More than an exceptional actor, David was a good man, and he was a good friend.
And we are so glad that David's family could be here today, and I'd like to introduce his brother Jim Compton to come and say a few words.
While I'm getting set up, I need to make a little correction in the program. Between native and Carolinian, you could strike north. But it's very confusing because I called us textile brats. Reason being, my father was a graduated Clemson, class of 54, back when there were two schools, agriculture and textiles. He chose textiles. Got married, and then Clemson being a military college, when he graduated, congratulations, you're now an officer in the United States Army. So he found himself in Fort Knox, Kentucky. And that's where I was born. and my brother Rob was born. And then when Dad resigned his commission, he moved back to Lawrence, South Carolina, which was his ancestral home. Went to work at Lawrence Mill, where his father worked and his brother worked. But then his high school education got him out of there. He moved up the road to Greenville, South Carolina. Yeah, Greenville, South Carolina. See, it's confusing. But while we were in Lawrence, our sister Becky was born. And she was just a handful, two or so, when we moved to Greenville. And then we stayed there for a good while. That's where David was born. And so I'd like to share some of the stories of how David came to be so dang good. Somebody that is talented, I guess, but it's not too late, so maybe you should take notes. All right. So, Mom said that at 4 years old, she knew David was going to be an actor. Because he's four. There was a car full of kids with Mom in a station wagon. We're headed home late in the afternoon. And Dave has a little fit because the last thing on the right before we turn up the mountain is a little store, and sometimes we get to stop and have Tootsie Pops. But Mom said, no, it's too late today. We'll spoil your dinner. No Tootsie Pops for anybody. As a fit. Very theatrical fit. And so she tells him to hush up, and then we turn, we make the right off the highway, and we start climbing up the mountain, and we're at the foot of Paris Mountain in North Carolina. And we used to play this game, and the sometimes when the fog would come in on the approach road, there was like, when it rained, the fog would come in, just almost obscure the mountain. And being little kids, you know, we called it the fog monster. So the fog monster was out there. He had eaten the mountain. And to break up the levity, you know, the tension of the car, I said, hey, look, David, the fog monster's ate the mountains. He's in the middle of the front seat right beside Mom. He goes, yeah, fog monster ate the mountains. Dark and rainy. No Tootsie Pops. Sob. And he was four. When they got home that evening, Mom told Dad, the boy is going to be an actor. So after Greenville, we really went into the textile rap mode. We made three moves in 4 years as Dad's talents were pretty much in the man. So he was just kind of carving a nice niche for his family. And we ended up in Dayton, North Carolina. Which and David was eight when we got there, and he really had a really idyllic chaplain. He had a really nice little ranch with some pasture. The place came with a pony and a tractor, and we'd walk a tenth of a mile to the end of the driveway, get on the school bus, and less than a mile, there's bait in the school. So it was pretty much a little piece of Never Never Land. And but David was 7 years younger than me. And so he's always, you know, the little guy, you know, I pat his hand, get out of here. So got up to 73, I graduated high school, and he was 11. And I shipped off to join the Navy. I came back 4 years later, he's 14, and there he is. He's eyeball to eyeball, it's the David that we all know, okay? And that was 77. And you know what happened in 77? A big event that took over preoccupied a lot of people's minds for a long, long time, including David Clay. We were fond of calling him David Clay. And that was Star Wars. Nothing but Star Wars. Yes, and I remember I came back and I drove him on a date because he was 15, couldn't drive. I drove him and his date to Charlotte, which is about an hour, and followed them around Charlotte, brought them back, and they were in the back seat, and I was doing the show for a bit, and the only thing he had in the car for us to listen was the soundtrack of Star Wars. On 8-track. There you go. Okay, but that was 77, and Dave had been bit by the bug in my absence. My mother was a charter member of the URA Players. Okay, and they had done a couple of really good productions getting going. Mom was hitting it pretty hard and heavy. She had a good role in The Fiddler on the Roof. She was the fiddler's wife. I don't know the roles. David Baker complimented. He said, "You were good, Mom. I didn't even think it was you." So that's a pretty good compliment, you know. So Mom was kind of had negotiated. Her and Dad had negotiated a little hiatus of her from the company for a little while, more productions. But they were doing Sound of Music. So, and Dave was 14, and she saw, Mom saw a order of the kids, and he said, "No, that's not right, David needs to be in there." So she, you know, I'm sure David came in well prepared, okay? He came in and they said, "But Joe, the kids are cast. So you haven't heard David, you gotta hear David. Would you please just hear him?" They heard him. David's in the show. There you go. So he had a great, really good soprano voice, held up really well for a while. He tells a story that I think is somewhere, maybe the middle of the run, there was a high note, and he just went. And I guess he'd been squeaking a little bit, but the older girl, hit the note for him. That's we're talking about, you know, a county player company. Okay. There was a lot of talent. So he's now in high school. And he's got his driver's license, he's in high school. And my mom, Jo, well, her, don't call her mom, call her Miss Jo. You see her in the lobby, she's Miss Jo, okay? So Miss Jo goes to the superintendent of the county schools, because David is going to North Stanley High School, and there is no drama in North Stanley, but there is drama in West Stanley High School, which is about, I don't know, 25, 30 mile drive. So then David just got his driver's license. And this is, so she goes and she has a negotiation with the county superintendent, and now David is going to both schools, taking drama. He's also, and at the other school, he's the drum major, an award-winning drum major. Every competition he goes to, he comes back with something, because he's just got that. So he's going to both. So he ends up going to both schools, and he actually sets the bar, because the next year they make it so other students can gravitate to both schools. So you thank Mom for that. She broke the mold. Before that, she said they only did it for football players. She said, "How many football players have you had make the bigs out of Santa County?" Said, you should do something besides sports. Okay, so I'm getting a little long. I'm gonna skip to the end here. I want to talk, I know that my dad was also very dirty. He bought into this. He knew that this is what David played really, you know, he's just shown for it, you know, he just ate it up. And so he was very supportive. So I'm gonna go down. And Mom was pretty good at nurturing. But the thing about Mom's nurturing was that Dave and her were pretty much on the same channel. They both have an annoying habit of not letting go of something. They will stick to it, and they know when it's right, and they know when it can be better, and they will stick at it until they are satisfied, for as long as it takes. Mom tells the story of when David was in college. You know, when I thought David's, you know, I don't know much about theater, but I thought David was really good at projection. He could really, you know, and his voice go up and down, you know, really good on that. And he was in college and he had a problem with that. And he came home and he was telling Mom, and Mom told him, "Just go down to the pasture and yell at the cows so you get it right." That's what he did. He was down there about 3.5 hours, but he got it right. And that was it. Another story about Mom and Joe. Well, Miss Joe just had her 80th birthday not too long ago. It was a surprise party. We called her Flatwood. It was really good. And so they went around and everybody wanted, they wanted somebody to tell a little thing about, you know, about Miss Joe. And it was kind of, And David, you know, he got down on his knees and right in front of him, because it was a room full of people, and he didn't want to, you know, be in a corner and try to talk. He went right up to her and kneeled, talked to her. And he told the story, and I've never heard it, but I think it's a really good one. When he was in college, he came home for the summer, he got a rejection letter because he didn't get to go to some workshop camp or something that they were having during the summer. So he was like, blah, 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 blah. And then I probably made a fit a little bit and started storming down the hall to his room. He said, next thing you know, somebody's grabbed him from the behind, spoke him up against the wall, and got a finger in his face and says, young man, you gotta get used to that. You gonna be in this business? You better get used to this. That was mom's nurture. Okay, so David gets through high school and he's like all this stuff going on and he is ready to college and you know where he's going to college. He's going to be an actor. He's like performing arts. And he meets his other brother, Scott Copeland, at UNCG. Scott comes up here not too long after. David comes up here. I want to tell a quick Scott story about the Iron Man episode. I'm talking to Scott in the hospital. I was telling about, I was just trying to keep an even keel until I got here, because, you know, I'm one of these guys, I don't really try to put things in my head, let them go crazy, until I get there and then see what we got. And I guess that's a little bit of mom and dad. But when I walked in there, I just had a vibe that everything was gonna be good. And very soon it started getting good, and I was telling Scott. Scott was just like, well, yeah. They don't know who they're dealing with. That's David Compton. So, excuse me. Now, in closing, nope, don't do that. I'd like to, I have to read this because I hope I get through it. I am not a well-read fellow, but I am sure that I am not the first to draw a correlation between theology and the theater. For the church is not cathedrals, men in robes and pointy hats, or television networks. Rather, it is a body of people bound in faith to the common good, who, through hard work, dedication, self-sacrifice, pour heart and soul into a continuing message from the heart of God. From the one big love that each of us carry in our hearts. Theater expresses this love, moves people's hearts and minds, creates new pathways to understanding and to reflect the truth that the big love wins over the petty fears and intolerance created by man. David often humbled me in introductions as the best big brother a guy could ever have. I extend that same compliment to each of you in this community. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for your outpouring of love and compassion, your generosity and caring for Dave and Amanda. Please carry on in your good works, and may the force, the big love, peace be with you. Thank you.
Oh. slightly rearranged. Sorry, grateful, regretful, happy. I looked for answers where none occur. You'll always be what you always were, which has nothing to do with all. Regretful, happy, you hold her thinking, I'm not alone, you're still alone. You don't live for her, you do live with her, you're scared she's starting to drift away, and scared she'll stay.
And David was an undergrad as a serious acting student. A very, very serious acting student. I moved on, and David was in Scott Copeland's thesis play, Treasure Island. David got it. He knew that good theater is good theater. The theater for young audiences needs to be damn good theater. Fast forward, Scott and I landed here at NCT, where there was a lot of suck to be removed. We asked our North Carolina friends and colleagues to help us out, and David was one who heeded the call. David brought amazing talent, instinct, astute perception, clarity, range, good Lord, physical precision, strength, humor. He took the work seriously, but not himself seriously. He raised everyone's game, and there's a lot of people in this room that know that. By our example, so shall we lead, and he did. Going through just briefly, Robin Goodfellow, I believe, was his first show with us many moons ago. Yes, he set Dara Modlin's ass on fire. That's true. Because I had to put it out. It was in the Odyssey. He was Treasure Island, Long John Silver. Put me on that. It was an amazing performance. It was the mime in Arkansas Bear and Victor Frankenstein. People in town were going, this guy seriously does not suck. What was I going to say? Hubba hubba He paired with Teddy Giles in Pinocchio for outrageous comedy and horrific evil. A transcendent role was Tuck, as the mute signing performance in Mother Hicks. Was one of the most amazing performances I've ever seen in my life. And there are many of you here with other theaters that will be able to say the same thing. He was, of course, a dog in Wiley and the Hairy Man, because let's face it, animals here at the Children's Theater, you gotta do them. David took a hiatus from the Children's Theater and shared his talents and his gifts with other theaters, and I'll get back to that. Fate allowed him to come back to the Children's Theater. He was with Holes. Second time with Robin Goodfellow, and I must say, that man could work a 9-foot cape. Sherlock Holmes, The Final Adventure, amazing. Lily's Purple Plastic Purse, Vermin, and for women. The Outsiders, a role that I need to comment on, The Cat, and Dr. Seuss's The Cat in the Hat. Even when his body was just so beat up, he courageously summoned the strength and grace to create a master performance. We were fortunate to enjoy his comedic prowess this season in Charlotte's Web, silly goose. We are grateful to have this celebration here on this stage. David and Amanda sharing with us a year with Frog and Toad. Sharing, back to it, and winding up. We are fortunate in Nashville, we have a theater community that embraces the notion of family, not territorial divisions. Let David be an example of bringing exemplary work and generosity everywhere, to celebrate good work from everyone, everywhere, to actively create an environment where artists can do their best work. A seat will hold a plaque to honor and commemorate David's contributions to Nashville Children's Theater here in the Ann Stallman Hill Auditorium forever. Thank you, David. It was and is an honor and a privilege and a riot to call you friend, colleague, cohort in crime. Thank you all, good hearts and true.
David had an amazing ability to reach into any character that he took on and find a truth and a strength and an integrity that even when that character had the darkest heart, you had to fight not to feel a certain amount of empathy. I can only imagine the thrill that it must have been to sit across from him at a table when he first took on Long John Silver, much less watching him get to performances where he would alternately bind one leg for one show, then one for the other, and change his choreography entirely for the fight scenes. For those of you not a member of the family, let me explain to you what this means is at one point he was left-handed and the next point he was right. This included a flying side kick which had to knock someone into a pit without hurting anyone twice a day. An incredible precision and intellect went into that. Sadly, you're not going to get any of that with me. No point in lying to you now. With apologies to Mr. Compton and Mr. Robert Louis Stevenson, a segment of Treasure Island. I now, Jim, so long as you're here, I've got you peace of my mind. I've always liked you. I have, for a lad of spirit, I've always wanted you to join and take your share, and now you've got to. Being as how you've got the chart, the treasure's as good as ours, your friends are beaten and soon bound for a better place. I don't say nothing as to come out to being in your our hands, though you are, and you may lay to that. I never seen good come out of threatening. If you like the service, well, you'll join up and become a gentleman of fortune. And if you don't, Jim, then you're free to answer no. Dirk slowly draws his cutlass. Free and welcome. Is that all? Well, it's all that you're to hear, my son. And now might choose. Morgan draws his cutlass. No hurry, time goes so pleasant in your company. Well, I'm not such a fool, but I know pretty well what I have to look forward to. But there's a thing or two I have to tell you, and the first is this. Here you are, in a bad way, your whole business done to wreck. And if you want to know who did it, it was I. I got the map from Billy Bones the night he died. I hid it with Pew. I was in the apple barrel when we sighted land. I heard your plan, Silver, and told every word of it, every word you said before the hour was out. And I had the top of this business from the first. Kill me or spare me as you please, but if you spare me, when you fellows are in court for piracy, I'll save you all I can. It's for you to choose. Kill me and do yourself no good, or spare me and keep a witness to save you from the gallows. Mr. Silver, if I'm to die, I'll take it kind of you to tell the squire and doctor how I took it. I'll bear it in mind. John, he squealed our plans. He stole the map from Billy Bones. Aye, first and last, we've split on Jim Hawkins. Then here goes, avast there. You be Captain Tom Morgan? By the powers, I'll teach you better. Cross me and you'll end up where many a man's gone afore ye. Some by the yardarm, some by the board, and all to feed the fishes. Tom's right. I've stood aising long enough from one. I'll be hanged if I'll be aised by you, John Silver. Did either of you gentlemen want to have it out with me? Well, I'm ready. Take a cutlass, him who dares, and I'll see the color of his insides, crutch and all. Well, you're pretty to look at anyway. If you won't fight, then by thunder you will obey. I'm captain here by election, and because I am the best man by a long sea mile. I like the boy. He's more a man than you little chambermaids, and he who lays a hand on him will have silver to answer to. You may lay to that. Now let's have a look at this chart.
To be on call and periodically checked on Matt Carlton. Actually, Matt Carlton arranged for a team of doctors to check on Matt Carlton years ago. So we arranged for a team of doctors to check on the team of doctors that was arranged to check on Matt Carlton. Fun fact, Matt Carlton's first doctor was the first doctor in Tennessee. Before it was a state, before it was America.
only two things that David requested happen at this celebration, and you're about to witness one of them. For many years, we've celebrated our birthdays in karaoke bars, and if Jenny Piper was in the room, she would sing Midnight Train to Georgia. And A. Tim, David, and I would always be her pips. So he says to Amanda, he says, "When I go, I want Jenny Piper to sing Midnight Train to Georgia." And so since David can't be here today, we've asked B.J. Rowell, who saved the Iron Man 4 years ago, to step up to the plate. So without further ado, here's Jenny Piper and the Pips. Sort of.
And live without him in my life. Johnson thought that was fucking funny.
Right at the top of the list for me. He was really brilliant.
Being directed by him was great, but actually getting to share the stage with him, I learned so much that summer. But David was more than just a fellow actor, director, and mentor. David brought me into his family. He was kind of the patriarch of this little family he was piecing together. And I guess he felt like I was dysfunctional enough to fit right in. And much like Buffy, one day I woke up and I had a little sister. Miss Rosemary. And on that note, I will hand the floor over to her.
Very conservative school. Can you say odd man out? The first time I met him, I was auditioning for a Christmas program we had there called Coco and Carols. And I walked in and he looked at me and he said, You wanna tell me what you're singing? And I went, oh. And he laughed at me. And that was the only time, because things quickly changed thanks to him. He made me not try. When I was 12, he cast my brother and I in South Pacific. It was my very first show, and I was hooked. I felt safe and loved and welcome. And strangely, at the exact same time I was doing that show with him, things with my real dad fell apart. And the universe seemed to have my back, as though it put David right there, saying, I found you, your perfect replacement. A man that was so loving and so encouraging, even if it had absolutely nothing to do with the show. Aside from directing me in 7 shows at school, he introduced me to most of you sitting in this room. He helped me start my career. But more importantly, he supported me in a way that only Dad could. He stayed on the phone with me while I cried when my first boyfriend broke up with me. He drove me to auditions when I didn't have my driver's license. He celebrated my 18th birthday with me and high school graduation. He lectured me on having safe sex when I went to college, ending the conversation with, have fun, but please don't go get an STD. He let me live with him when my parents got divorced and my whole life was in my car in boxes. He supported me through the hardest points of my life, and I him, but he never wanted help in return. Despite my best efforts, call it being a chivalrous, old school kind of guy, or call it being a parent. A really, really good parent. David taught me to sing loud. Like Jim said, you never wanted a microphone anywhere near anybody. He wanted you to project like your life depended on it. He taught me how to decorate a house and to love the 60s. I'm still thankful I inherited some random pieces when he left 1818. But more importantly, he taught me that family doesn't just mean someone that you share cells with. It means anyone that you love, anyone that you spend time with and want to share your gifts and talents with. And I'm so thankful that I got to share my gifts and talents with him. I miss him like crazy already. But I'm thankful for the giant family that he created with all of you. David maybe never had children, but we are all his offspring. If you ever had a conversation with him, acted with him, or directed or coached by him, or even just watched him in a play, chances are your life was enriched. And I said this on Facebook and I'll say it here. While it's true, there will never be another David Compton, and his body may have been forever taken from the stage, he has not been taken from the stage. So many of us have learned so much from him over the years. And in that way, little pieces of David are scattered on stages everywhere. Thank you.
I knew, but I didn't know until David walked into his audition for Exeter in Henry V. How amazing an actor he was. He walked in and he apologized to me and Denise because he didn't feel that he had been adequately prepared for the audition, which is ridiculous. He read the monologue I'm about to read a piece of to you, and 1 minute later, Denise and I were sitting behind our table in the Studio B set at NPT with tears running down our faces. This was not expected from an Exeter monologue. If you saw David perform this, you know why. As a director, one of my first tasks is to find what vibrates naturally in an actor and then have them fight this, knowing it will vibrate through them no matter what. I find it helps to create a dynamic performance. There's always one thing that I can find, and sometimes two, three if I'm lucky. But with David, everything vibrated in him. Power, peace, beauty, humility, wackiness, pain, violence, and always love and kindness. David was the greatest of human instruments. Everything was there, and because he was so generous, everything was accessible to serve the piece he was working on and to serve the people that he loved. Every extra I've ever seen vibrated power and confidence, but the reason none of them could hold David's jock was because he added a compassion and empathy that broke your heart and made you hear a voice for the widows, the orphans, the fathers, all those powerless in the situation. As Exeter and in life, he was an unapologetic and irreverent voice of power for the powerless. For if you hide the crown, even in your hearts, there will he rake for it. Therefore, in fierce tempest he is coming, in thunder and an earthquake like a Jove, that if requiring fail, he will compel and bid you in the bowels of the Lord deliver up the crown and to take mercy on the poor souls for whom this hungry war opens his vasty jaws, and on your head turning the widow's tears, the orphan's cries, the dead men's blood, the pining maiden's groans for husbands, fathers, and betrothed lovers that shall be swallowed in this controversy. This is his claim, his threatening, and my message. If I could selfishly take a moment to go back over two lines from that for myself. I keep, since the moment I found out, I don't know why, but I keep looking up to the heavens, and I imagine David riding various modes of transportation in the clouds. It was a moped this morning, which is awesome. And I look up and I just say, therefore, in fierce tempest is he coming, in thunder and an earthquake like a Jove, as if I'm warning God to get ready because it's about to get crazy.
Apologies for reading, but there's a bit of a personal anecdote that goes along with this next part, and my thoughts are somewhat clearer on the book. If you were lucky enough to share the stage with David Compton, you were probably struck, as I was, by, of course, his immense talent and versatility, but also, and possibly more striking, his daring vulnerability. That terrifying openness and courage all good actors strive for, and all truly great actors like David have in abundance. My experience of this was never more apparent than during the St. Crispin's Day speech scene in Nashville Shakespeare's Henry V last summer. Yes, the speech was Henry's, the voice was mine, but if there was any truth to that moment of the play, it was all David's. Each night, as I waded through the house, up onto the stage to hit my mark for that do or die beginning of "No, My Fair Cousin," my nerves would always get up a bit. This being a speech so many know too well. And as the adrenaline and fear would begin to sabotage all of my best efforts, I would look at David, Henry's Exeter,
moored to the stage and the earth like an oak in a storm. His eyes and his heart brimmed full of all the courage Henry needed. And that sweet smile we all know so well reached deep into my chest and whispered, "Come on, Matt, give it to me." Every night, St. Crispin's Day was lifted from David's heart. Forever, Henry V, for me, the St. Crispin's Day speech will be David's. Sorry, Kenneth Branagh. My experience of those words will always be David Carr. Doing this speech for you today, I won't have David standing at my shoulder. I won't have his eyes or that sweet smile. But the courage he so generously gave me night after night after night remains, and my heart is in the tremble.
No, my fair cousin, if we are marked to die, we are enough to do our country loss. And if to live, the fewer men, the greater share of honor, God's will, our craving, wish not one man more! By Jove, I am no covetous for gold, nor care I who doth feed upon my cost. It yearns me not if men my garments wear, but if it be a sin to covet honor, I am the most offending soul alive. No, faith, my cause, wish not a man from England. Rather, proclaim it, Irvingham, through my host, that he which hath no stomach to this fight, let him depart. His passport shall be made, and crowns for convoy put into his purse. We would not die with that man that fears his fellowship to die with us. This day is called the Feast of Crispian. He that shall live this day and come safe home will stand a tiptoe when the day is named and rouse him at the name of Crispian. He that shall live this day and see old age will yearly on the vigil feast his neighbors and say tomorrow is St. Crispin's Day. Then we strip his sleeve and show his scars and say, "These wounds I have on Christmas Day." Old men forget that all shall be forgot, but he'll remember with advantages what feats he did that day. Then shall our names, familiar in his heart as household words, Harry the King, Bedford, be in their flowing cups, freshly remembered. This story shall the good man teach his son, and Crispin Crispin shall never go by from this day until the ending of the world, but we in it shall be remembered. We few, we happy few, we band of brothers, for he today that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother, be he ne'er so vile, this day shall gentle his condition. And gentlemen in England now abed shall think themselves accursed they were not here, and hold their manhoods cheap whilst any speaks that fought with us upon St. Crispin's Day.
History as an actor and a director and a designer and a friend. And, whew, law, I'm nervous. nervous. I'm scared. Because history, as with much of life, is complicated and messy and scary, but it's also beautiful and tender, so I just hope my heart will open up. I moved to Nashville in around 1987, but I didn't really get involved in theater until I joined the Reps training program in the 88-89 season. And it was at that time that I came here to this very theater where you are out there sitting, and to see a show, to see a children's theater show, what I thought. I fell in love that day with this beautiful blonde boy playing a deaf mute. How the hell was he able to move me so much? And he never said a word. I was mesmerized. Dan spoke about it earlier. I believe it was Mother Hicks was the name of the show. It was a truly captivating performance and it just made me weep. So I saw that it was this guy named David Compton, and I thought, damn, he's so good and beautiful, but good. So I got to meet him after the show, and he was so gracious and humble, and I was hooked, let me just say. I was hooked. And we got to be friends over the next year or so, and I mean, some of my fondest memories over the last 27 years are with him, both on and off the stage. He worked for pretty much every company in town and out of town. He was a true Renaissance man. He could do, I swear, anything, particularly in regards to theater. I mean, that boy, his bag of tricks that we'd like to talk about in our bag of tricks, which mine is like, and in my pocket, his was fucking huge. I don't know how he carried it around. He was equally comfortable with comedy and drama, musical theater, straight plays, Jack Sharkey, Shakespeare. Oh yes, oh yes. He had a gift for physical comedy that was so much fun to watch. He patterned after some of his heroes like Dick Van Dyke and Danny Kaye. I had the privilege to share the stage with him on several occasions. But one of my favorite memories of him was when I was hired to be a reader for the callbacks for the Reps production of Romeo and Juliet. And he had been called back for Benvolio. As I read with him, the emotion and honesty that he brought to that audition left me in tears and in awe. I was blown away. I was so caught up in it. I was like, I love you. Needless to say, he got the role, and dozens and dozens and dozens of other ones over the years. But, you know, he was more than just an actor on the stage. He did film work, he did television, he made a TV movie with Joanna Cassidy. I don't remember the name of it, sorry. I just thought it was cool that he made a movie with Joanna Cassidy. Amanda Lamb, who are you, Amanda? I need your love. Anyway, she just posted a wonderful video that he did with Reba McEntire for her hit, The Night the Lights Went Out in Georgia. And they did this whole story with it. It's very cool. He played a reporter investigating, and it was, you know, really dramatic. But it is fucking awesome. And if you haven't seen it, you should check that out on YouTube. But as everybody has spoken about, he was more than just an actor. He was equally at home as a director, a choreographer. He choreographed The Barn's My Fair Lady. I music directed it. It was beautiful to watch him work in that. He was a fight choreographer, a set designer, a lighting designer, a master carpenter, flat painter. I mean, the boy did it all. Whatever it took, he could do it, and he did it. I was lucky enough to be directed by him in the production of Guys and Dolls, one of my favorite roles, Nicely Nicely. And he knew how to coax the best performance out of you as an actor, and he was always challenging, but so supportive and beautiful. Most of my history, and a lot of the history of the Nashville Theater, and here's where it may get a bit awkward and uncomfortable, was with he and Martha. They shared close to 20 years together and started numerous plays together. One of the earliest being a production I was privileged to be in, The Rep, Our Town, where they were beautiful George and Emily. I love that show. They became my family here in Nashville. We joked that I was his gay wife and her gay husband. That was gay in the scenario, that's all. He loved Halloween, and we checked out pretty much every haunted house, haunted mansion, haunted prison, haunted woods, haunted gas station, whatever. Over the years, we gathered at Christmas to watch our favorite animated Christmas shows. How the Grinch Stole Christmas was our personal favorite. But there was usually Charlie Brown on it, Rudolph, and maybe a couple other ones. The house on Willow Springs became the central gathering place for most of the theater community. And the parties there were epic! The boy knew how to host a party. So when that relationship ended, it was hard, devastating even, for them, for me, for a lot of us. But you know, that's life. Ever-changing, complicated, beautiful. You know, David moved on, and he found another beautiful love with Amanda Card. And I was so happy to see him happy again. Was a gift. He continued to grow and challenge himself as he always did. with roles and directing. And if there's anybody in this room that did not see his turn as the MC in Cabaret, well, it was sheer brilliance. I've even heard through the grapevine that he was at auditions as recently as a couple of weeks ago for Studio Tenn. Amazing. I looked on Facebook, I've been living on Facebook for the last 2 or 3 days. And some of the things that were said by various people, an incredibly generous actor, true and honest friend, one of the most honest and loving actors and human beings I've ever known. One of the key words in that is honest. And that says it all right there. He was honest in his work, in his life, in the love he gave to all of us. What a legacy. The last couple of years when I would see him, I would whine, because you know I'm a whiner. I would bemoan the fact that we weren't as close, and I was worried that we weren't as close, and yada, yada. And he would just look at me and go, "Don't worry about it, Tim. I love you, and you love me. It's okay." So I'm trying to hear those words as we speak about him in the past tense, which is just so fucked up. So I share those words with you. Don't worry about it. I love you. You love me. It's okay. And I hope that someday it will feel okay again. I love you all.
Baby,
could tell the story of when David was doing Glengarry Glen Ross at the Rep and dyed his hair red, and then dyed the carpet to match the drapes, but I won't. I could tell the story of how I passed out at his house during a cast party, and he had to get up early the next morning to go teach the children. And he came in the room where I was sleeping and waved his penis over me like some sort of shaman. He told me later, but I won't. I could tell the story of when I told David I was getting married to a girl. And asked him to be a groomsman, and he responded, "Is one of you in danger of being deported?" But I won't. What I will tell you is that David Compton was a good man, a good actor, and a good friend. And he inspired me to be better at all three. A quote I found on the internet kind of sums up our friendship. A good friend knows all your stories. A best friend has lived them with you. And that's so true of what David is to me. I met David in 1998 when I was auditioning for Guys and Dolls that Tim just spoke about at Chaffin's Barn. I drove over from Little Rock, having just done my first professional show. I had a tube of chapstick and my dance belt tags all ready to go. I had played Jeffrey in college. I don't know if you know the play Jeffrey, because Nashville doesn't really do gay plays, but... y'all know it's true. Anyway, I did a monologue from Jeffrey in whatever inappropriate 16 bars I had chosen to sing, and somehow I got a call back. Long story short, too late. The show called for a Cuban dancer, and being vaguely ethnic, Laura Matula, you feel me? David cast me in my first show in Nashville because I was the most Cuban looking thing that showed up. I'm sure that there are several of you in this room who can say David Compton cast me in my first show. I can say without a doubt, my life would be very different today if he hadn't taken a chance on me. There are lots of relationships in this room that would not exist if that hadn't happened. For instance, I would never have met Lee Epler. There would be no Osborne and Epler. There would be no Southern Fried Funeral. And if there were no Southern Fried Funeral, there would be no pool in my backyard. To know David was to love David. He was one of the most giving and kind people on this earth. We did Funny Money together at the barn several years ago, and it was his show. I mean, the show was about his character. But there were several instances throughout the show where he would allow his scene partner to shine. Never any ego, never any one-upsmanship, never any doubt that if you deserved the moment, he was more than happy to let you have it. If you didn't deserve it, you were screwed when the curtain came down. There was a point when we became more than good acquaintances. We became good friends. And I'm going to tell this story again because Jen and I did not compare notes before we got up here. But I think it was the afternoon of tech rehearsal for Bo and Boeing at the barn, and we were doing this British farce. And let me just say for the record, I don't remember me being that quite condescending to Jen. Sometimes I mean it. Anyway. But David was directing it, and he was a master at farce. And to be honest, our play was sort of all over the floor. We were out there on that 16 by 16 like a bunch of assholes. Nothing was really working right. Nate and I were the two leads, which we still don't know how that happened, and sort of had no idea what we were doing. I would also like to point out, Jennifer Richmond, that my mother had a double mastectomy while we were in rehearsal for that, so give me a little break. The rest of you, I don't have that same excuse. Anyway, at one point in our tech through, the gal playing the maid didn't know her lines, and we're all standing on stage. And I'm looking at her, and she starts to well up as if she's going to cry, and out loud I say, please don't cry. Please don't cry. Whatever you do, please don't cry. We're going to get through it. Come to find out, her father had a heart attack in New Orleans, and she wasn't ever going to be able to get it together enough to be in the play. So we finished the run that afternoon. David broke several pencils. And when we came back from the dinner break, David was in the play with us as the maid. We ran the show, it was a totally different play. We were getting all the jokes, Jim's already said this. We were making all our entrances and exits, and we were remembering what the hell came next. All because David put on a dress and a wig and made it work and made it seem easy. And it was during that 6-week run that we all sort of started dating. The six of us in the play, but that David and I became really close. I could go on and on, but frankly, I'm pretty sure that I can't. I know these things to be true. I love David, and he loved me. He was and is the true love of a man's life. We are all grieving. He's gonna make fun of me because I'm crying. Shut up, you're joking. We have all suffered a major loss, and my heart is breaking. But as a good friend of mine says, sometimes it's good for your heart to break a little. For it's when there are cracks in the heart that the light can shine. David will always, always be a light shining into my heart. And I can only hope that I can reflect that light back out into the world in some small way. I will end with this. A true friend accepts you for who you are, but also helps you to become who you should be. David Compton helped me become who I should be. And I will be eternally grateful.
A treasure. I just hear him. Oh, yeah. Like, he is in a better place. Well, yes, maybe. But it's not a place where we can get together for drinks, and frankly, I have some shit I need to talk to you about, man. It's too big, it happened too fast, and there aren't sufficient words to describe the loss that we're feeling. David Compton was the finest actor I ever saw on stage. I watched him hundreds of times from the audience and from the wings and from right there on stage with him. And he was always brilliant. He electrified the space. He didn't draw attention to himself. He thought flashy was a waste of time. He cared about his audiences, but his satisfaction wasn't in you watching. His satisfaction was in doing it elegantly and simply and truthfully. His satisfaction was in moving your heart. As a director, his technical mastery was out of this world. He loved the old school comedy mechanicals. He loved spit takes and pratfalls and door bits, and he was a master of the triple. It didn't matter if it was your first time on stage or your 100th, he respected everyone he worked with. Even you, Brian. He treated everyone as real artists all working towards the same goal. Even you, Brian. He truly loved the actors he was on stage with. Even you. He was my big brother. He taught me so much without trying. He was my friend, though towards the end we were hanging out in a lot of hospital rooms, so I would always say, well, this isn't the weirdest thing we've done together. And he'd say, yep, and it was true. Thankful for all the time I got with him, but all things considered, I think I'd give anything for one more drink on the porch. It occurred to me the other night that there will soon be people who move to Nashville that do not know David Compton. That eventually, there will be actors and actresses marching across our stages that didn't see how effortlessly he moved, who don't know how hard he worked, who don't grasp the standard he set. The thought of that made me cry for 2 hours. Not just because that means that housing prices are gonna keep going through the roof, but because I can't bear to see David Compton erased. So please don't let that happen. I can't keep him alive. I can't give back all the things that were taken. But together we can tell stories about David to everyone who will listen. If a life can be measured by the stack of amazing stories you leave behind, David Compton led a tremendous life, the kind of life we'd all be lucky to have. Every single one of us knew him, had some part of him. We all have some story of David that is just ours, that nobody else knows. And I ask you now to please tell them. I hope that we all tell them every chance we get. Thank you.
In 2012, we used to email each other poems every day. And I saved them all because David Compton was sending me love poems. And yeah, I can say that. I cannot pronounce the name of the person who wrote this poem. So if you want to know, ask me after and I will show it to you and you can read it. But here's a poem that David sent to me. Like the warmth of the morning sun, so do thoughts of you embrace me, revealing how alive I am. A glorious light of the new day, so is your presence in my life, relieving it of its shadows and marking the start of a new beginning. David Compton, I love you. I will love you till the day I die. Thank you.
We talked about doing this song, I at first thought, well, that's just so wrong, but it's not. David, and I apologize, Rachel, to you, David Compton was a craftsman. He was a craftsman, but he would never say that, and you never saw him work his craft. If you were in rehearsal, you'd see it, he did it all somewhere else, and he didn't show that. He showed it when he with a hand gesture, and you got who this entire character was that might not even have a name in the production. He didn't want that spotlight on him. He didn't care if it was there or not. That didn't have anything to do with it. But you looked at him. With that being said, I would like to bring out Mr. Sean Knight to sing Mr. Sullivan.
Notice him. Hush. human beings made of more than air. With all that bulk, you're bound to see him there. And that's not human being next to you. It's unimpressive, undistinguished. You know who.
Also, there's beer and wine in the lobby afterwards. Tell your story.